Welcome to Tech Talk, and today's topic is about phishing and ransomware. And we want to answer the question, should you pay a ransom? And so you talked about this in a prior video about how to defend yourself against it. But now we want to say, let's assume it's already happened. That bad news. Where do we go with that?
Yeah, this is the problem, because every one of us could potentially be a target. So we need to understand what we're going to do if, in fact, it occurs.
The funny thing is, and maybe not the funny thing that happened is I have a friend who was hit by a ransomware attack, and they demanded money, just like you always hear, and they had encrypted his database or his laptop. In the end, he decided not to pay. And I want to really understand better from a security perspective, what were his options? What were the things that he could or should have decided to make that decision easier?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first of all, so I feel bad for your friend, but your friend is not alone. A lot of people get hit by this. And we've got cases where it's an individual, so it's an individual person who gets hit. And then we've got cases where organizations get hit. And it could be everything in between. We've got attackers who are very unsophisticated, and they send out an attack to just snag anybody that they possibly can. And that's probably what happened to your friend.
So there are small fish they're going after, but there's a lot of them.
Exactly. They make it up in volume. Or you've got the others that may be trying for very specific targets, high-value targets, and they may be very elite hackers that are doing this. And they're breaking into systems using zero-day attacks and things like that in order to get in to go after what they know are the keys to the kingdom.
Well, there's been some cases in the news that have really gotten a lot of play. I think you mentioned one of those before we started recording.
Yeah, exactly. There was one with the Colonial Pipeline organization, which shut down gas production and distribution, I guess probably just distribution, for much of the Southeast for a number of weeks. And that was as a result of an attack related to ransomware.
But they were using, were they attacking the control systems or some other? What was their strategy for that?
Based upon the information we have from public sources, it was a case where they attacked the billing system. So actually the oil could still be distributed technically, but if they couldn't charge for it, they had no records for it, nobody wants to run a business like that. So they had to wait until they could get that system recovered until they could go ahead and start operating again.
So they paid.
They paid.
They paid, and in the end, what happened?
Well, so there's really three things that could happen if you pay. One is, what sounds like the good case, is you get your data back. That's what everybody's hoping for. I pay, I get my data, end of story. There's another case that can happen here where you get a decryption tool of some sort. That's what happened in the Colonial Pipeline case, again, based upon the publicly available information. And the decryption tool turned out to be so slow and so ineffective that they had to rely on their own backups anyway. So they paid, but they really didn't get much for what they paid. And then the third option is you get absolutely nothing. The ransomware attacker takes your money and gives you nothing in return. So now not only have you lost your precious memories, your photos, or your corporate data, you also lost your money in the process. And you would think this looks like one possible good outcome because I got what I was after. But I'll tell you what this also does is it signals to the bad guys, this is a potential soft target. Mm-hmm. Because your system was vulnerable this time, maybe you haven't fixed it for the next time, and we already know you're willing to pay, so if I get you between the crosshairs again, maybe you'll pay again. So you've now signaled to the world you're a sucker.
In the case of my buddy, he decided not to pay. And that's because he followed some of your advice, maybe that would say how to create really good backups. And so he did have some data loss, but not completely. What do you think about his approach, and what would you advise to our viewers to avoid becoming his sort of victim?
The best thing you can do is make sure you've got good backups. And you have to start that now. You can't do that after you've been attacked. It's too late to do a backup then. So that would be the first thing you could do. The next thing you could do is try to make sure that the information you have is well protected, with multi-factor authentication and things like that, that we talked about in a previous talk. Those are the kinds of things that will help protect you in advance. But once you've already been attacked, if it evaded those defenses or you didn't have those defenses in place, then you're back to the question of pay or no pay.
There's also a legal and moral question to be considered too, right?
There definitely is. In fact, if you think about it this way, if I pay this guy, I've basically rewarded him for bad behavior. And there's no incentive for him to stop doing it. He's going to keep doing it and keep doing it and keep doing it as long as he gets paid. Now, I understand as an individual, though, you're not concerned necessarily about what happens to everybody else. You just want your data back. Mm-hmm. If you're an organization, you need your company running again. But there is that consequence. And then there's also the legal part, and I'm not a lawyer, so you should consult your own lawyer on this, but there's some discussion about whether it's even legal to pay a ransom. And why might it be illegal? Well, because the money you're giving could be going, well, is going to criminals for sure. It could be funding a criminal enterprise. It could be funding terrorists for that matter. So we don't know this kind of thing when you pay, but you could be giving money to people that are literally enemies of the state, and therefore you would be complicit.
Wow. One thing before we wrap I wanted to bring up is that in the case of my buddy, he was looking at an encrypted hard drive. But there are other cases where ransomware comes into play. For example, someone hijacks your email and is demanding payment in order to retrieve access. Or say, for example, they have a image repository and they've done that. What is your advice to avoid becoming susceptible to that kind of attack?
Again, it's going to be backups. Because in those cases, if I've got a repository and someone hijacks my credentials to that repository and says, I'm not going to give you access to your own credentials because I've changed the password now, then the only thing you could really do to avoid having to pay and end up with all the problems that we talked about is make sure you have a way to recover that. If you have stored those in another service, mm-hmm. like maybe another cloud repository, and you've not used the same password for both of them, then there's a good chance that maybe you could recover from another source. But the thing you can't rely on necessarily is being able to go to the provider. Mm-hmm. If it was a free account, they're probably not going to help you. Because as the old saying goes, if you're not paying for it, you're the product, not the customer. And if you didn't pay for that photo site that's storing all your photos, then you are not the customer. And products don't get to call up and complain. So they're that's using really, your information.
That's really true. And one thing you can do to keep in mind is that a lot of even the free services have a download capability where yes. you can download that. You can also use, for example, if you're using email, you can have it replicated to your laptop and then which you can back up. These are ways that you can recover it locally. And I think that pretty much covers our strategy. Oh, one other thing, multi-factor authentication.
Absolutely.
You mentioned that is that can you kind of explain really quickly for those who haven't seen the video, it's you can watch it here.
Yeah, multi-factor authentication says I'm going to use something more than just your password alone because someone might steal your password or guess it and then change it and then not tell you. But if I've used a second factor or even a third factor, such as something I have, like a phone that's been pre-registered, and I'm going to send a text message or a push notification to that phone, if you don't have that in your possession, you can't log in. Or a biometric, like your face or your finger, and the phone uses that to unlock the account. If you're using these other kinds of things, it's much harder for an attacker to duplicate those kind of authentication capabilities. So you could guard against that in the first place. And then there's even yet other types of ransomware attacks where I'm not stealing your data or your access, but I'm threatening that I'm going to do a denial of service mm-hmm. on your network. And in those cases, we need yet different types of defenses to make sure that we can block the extraneous traffic that's coming in and do it at as close to the source as possible. So there's a lot of different mitigations that happen here, but the number one thing is to make sure you're prepared.
That's some excellent advice, and I think that's a wrap for us. Thanks again, and if you have topics you'd like to hear on Tech Talk, be sure and drop us a comment below. And before you leave, please do us a favor and remember to hit like and subscribe.